time for another bonus. This week for the gameplay, I have some Uncharted 2 Among Thieves. Finally got around to playing the Uncharted series, and well, they're all right, aren't they? Work-wise, things are ticking over. I'm still working on Nuclear Fruit. I've written the majority, that is to say I've written 3 out of 5 parts now, and I'm currently producing the first parts. I've been recording games and stuff for that. I have come to the conclusion that this might be the most ambitious project I have ever embarked upon. So hopefully, people will enjoy it. I always liken this sort of time to, it's like baking an invisible cake. You can't see the ingredients, you can't see what you're doing, you can't see when you're cooking it, you can't see if it's burned or perfect, and then you've got to ice it and you can't see where it is, and then you've got to serve it, and then people are like, this cake is rubbish. That, to me, is what the creative process is like. It's like baking an invisible cake. But fret not, because I'm a master baker of these metaphorical cakes. Otherwise, I've been playing a lot of Dirt Rally recently, and I got The Witcher 3 as well, which I've been playing and thoroughly enjoying. It really is a good game, actually. It puts Dragon Age Inquisition to shame, and I quite liked Dragon Age Inquisition. Young Money 19 says, what are the next guns on deck for Iconic Arms? At this point in time, I have absolutely no idea. Iconic Arms is a few projects away. First of all, we've got Nuclear Fruit to finish, then we've got a series of Retrohoy, and then I've got another short mini-series of 3 episodes planned of Origins. After that, Iconic Arms could return. But as far as I'm concerned, it's over the horizon. I see a lot of requests, though, an awful lot of requests, so I've got a pretty good idea of what people want. There are probably going to be a couple of generic episodes. I'd really like to talk about flamethrowers. I'd also quite like to talk about what else? Maybe chainsaws. Also, there's stuff like crossbows. And also rocket launchers as well. The RPG-7 is something that's requested more than I thought it would be. I mean, I get it. It's the most iconic rocket launcher, but I don't know. I think a generic episode on rocket launchers would probably work better. Then I can talk about Doom, I can talk about Quake. It is, after all, one of the archetypal video game weapons. The rocket launcher. So that leaves us with 4 slots. And there are a surprising amount of real-life guns, which I could cover. The P90 is a very likely inclusion. I've seen that one requested a lot. And it's a unique-looking gun. Interesting. Been in a few games. Definitely a strong contender. The FNFAL. Not quite as iconic as you might think. It is one of my favourites, but, you know, it's just one of those guns that's kind of there. But it would make a good counterpart to the P90, so I might open the series with the FAL and then close the series with the P90. That would be quite fitting because, the FAL is the 3rd weapon in the series of Cold War weapons, that is the AK-47, the M16, and then, the FAL would be 3rd. That leaves us with a couple of slots, so what else? Maybe something historical. The Thompson, perhaps? The MP40? The Mosin Nagant? All strong contenders, definitely. So what else is there? You know, there's stuff like the Glock, there's the AUG, there's the G36. The Germans would appreciate a G36, I think. There are a bunch. I'll decide nearer the time, though. Callum McBride says, have you ever been to Scotland, in particular Glasgow? If so, what do you think of the place? I've been to Scotland many times. I mean, my mum's from there, my dad's from there. So I'm of a full Scottish lineage, really. It's just, so happens I was born in Preston. As for Glasgow, I've been there, I think, at least once, maybe a couple of times. I remember the once I was only passing through. I was on my way to Stirling for someone's birthday. And I arrived at the central station in Glasgow and I thought, wow, this is really nice. Then I went to the city centre and everything was all sort of lit up with blue lighting at night. And it was like, wow, this is really nice. There's a few too many hen nights hanging out of limousines, but it's quite nice. And then I got to Queen Street Station and realised that not all of Glasgow is nice. Still, anyway, Scotland. Yeah, I like Scotland. I could live there if, you know, it wasn't for ties to friends and family down here. Captain Bogrell says, how much cake can you consume in one sitting? That depends, doesn't it? I mean, it depends on whether I've got an empty stomach or not. Because if I'm ravenous, I could probably have more than one slice, if you know what I mean. But if I've just had, like, you know, a regular meal, I think one slice might be enough. I could maybe force down 2, but more than that, I wouldn't light a bet on. If we're talking empty stomach, you know, eating contest condition sort of thing, maybe I could have a whole cake. Depends on how big the cake is. Messiah of Fire says, do you play any instruments? And what do you think about modern music in comparison to older music? My key instrument's probably the sequencer/synthesizer. You know, computer music, really. If you're talking real instruments, then I've got limited experience with a guitar. I can, you know, rattle out a few chords, nothing special. I played the recorder at primary school. As far as old music versus new music, I mean, depends what you mean. Are you talking like the Beatles versus Kasabian, or are you talking like Beethoven versus music in the last 50 years? Either way, I don't suppose it matters too much. There's merit in modern music, just as much as there is merit in older music as well. I mean, don't get me wrong, I don't like a lot of the modern stuff that comes out, but some of it, I actually do, yeah. There is some good music out there. Fatal Plays Matthew says, what do you think of the Black Ops 3 trailer, features, etc? Well, it looks good, and I do have confidence in Treyarch to make a quality product. But part of me can't help but feel like maybe Future Warfare just isn't that interesting to me. I'll still give it a chance, though. I think I'm doomed to buy every single Call of Duty until the end of time. Because the real question is, am I going to do a weapon guide for it? The answer is probably not, but I'll feel bad about that because I've done a pretty good job with the first Black Ops and Black Ops 2. Chozerman22 says, do you have a favourite historical figure? Yes, Hourglass. Isaac Wangan says, Stu, have you ever played the Dark Souls series? If so, what did you think of it? I've played a very, very small portion of Dark Souls 1 and Dark Souls 2. I do feel like I should play them some more. And what I might do is I might, you know, maybe look up like some tips, walkthrough maybe, just to get me into it. Because it is fair to say that those games are quite unforgiving. And it requires a certain degree of patience to sort of crack. So the only times I've really played them is, you know, to get footage for a video. And in those cases, I'm not really fully invested in the game. I just want to get some clips. So I should probably come back to them with a bit more determination. So Stewie says, how are you, Stu? What do you, A, want Valve to release next? And B, think Valve will release? What do I want? Half-Life 3. What do I think we'll get? Left 4 Dead 3. I don't know, I kind of feel like Valve has got out of the games business almost. But that's probably because I'm not that interested in Dota 2, and I'm not really interested in Counter-Strike round-based gameplay either. I don't mind CSGO, I think it plays pretty well, but for some reason, round-based multiplayer, it's just not my cup of tea. And I know there's Arms Race, and I know there's Team Deathmatch on some servers, and they're fun for a while, but you know, the game isn't really designed for Deathmatch. So anyway, I'm thirsty for some single-player Valve experiences. It would be very nice to see a single box, like the Orange Box, with Half-Life 3, Left 4 Dead 3, maybe, Portal 3. That would be nice. But you know how Valve time operates. Damon Schuller says, hey Stu, what are your thoughts on EA's plans to sell 9 to 10 million copies of the new Battlefront? Seems a bit much to me. It does seem ambitious, doesn't it? I mean, Star Wars is a pretty big name, but Battlefield 4... I mean, Battlefield's a pretty big name in and of itself, and Battlefield 4 came out on Gen 7, Gen 8, and PC, and still didn't sell 9 or 10 million copies. So, I guess it could happen, but they're going to have to make a really good game that reviews really well. So, I guess we'll see. I mean, I'm not even sure if I'm going to buy it yet. Moleman978 says, hey Stu, have you seen the film Interstellar? If so, what did you think of it? I haven't yet. I will see it at some point. I've seen Gravity, I've seen Moon, but I haven't yet seen Interstellar. I'll probably add it to my rental list at some point. I like renting Blu-rays. The quality's better than streaming, and it'll take advantage of my surround sound setup. Next up on my watch list, City of God, the Brazilian slum film, and Escape from New York, which I've never seen before. It's got, what's his face, Kurt thingy. And he has to escape from New York, I can only presume. Clinton Cuddington says, why do you have two channels? Do you get more money for having two channels, or is there another reason? It's for my own benefit, really. I like to keep my demented rambling separate to my actual productions. So I like my main channel to be neat and clean, and every single video I want to be a high quality one. I would probably make marginally more money if I uploaded these videos to my main one. Certainly in the short term. I don't know about the long term though, probably even out. But it's really more to do with my own desire to keep my channels in an orderly state. Agent Tuck says, hey Stu, glad to see you're still here. I know I'm probably asking something stupid here, but what's your honest opinion on PewDiePie and his fan base? I'm not sure about the fan base. All I know is that they're broad and they identify, what's it, the Brofist Army, something like that. But PewDiePie, he gets some flack, but I think he's a genius of sorts. He's forged an entirely new form of gaming entertainment, and he's become incredibly successful as a result. I mean, all right, there might have been an ounce of luck in his success. Right place, right time and all that. And, well, right videos, right reactions, right scary games. But yeah, I mean, yeah, you know, he's done well. And it's almost reassuring to see a gaming channel do that well. Because it reaffirms that there is potential on YouTube. So yeah, he's done good. A lot of people have emulated his style of videos, for better or for worse. Which is a shame, because I think that constitutes an erasure of individual style. And, you know, maybe not everybody's got a valuable individual style, but I do think diverse voices are one of the strengths of YouTube. So to see PewDiePie's success spawn a homogenized style is a little bit disheartening, but, you know, well, it works. People love that style of content for some reason. Personally, I'm banking on the demographics of YouTube shifting slightly older, so that there's a larger body of people wanting more serious content. That's what I'm banking on. It might not happen. That's no reason not to try, though. Yeagy says, hey Stu, you mentioned trip-hop in your favourite genres. What do you think about jazz-hop, down-tempo, and ambient? Jazz-hop, I don't think I've got any real experience with. I do like some down-tempo, some ambient stuff, though. What comes to mind? I'm a big fan of Boards of Canada. Similarly, I like Lemon Jelly. They're pretty good. They're kind of trip-hoppy, but also kind of down-tempo as well, but Portishead are quite good. There's probably quite a few minor artists in that sort of constellation. Who else? Blue States, they come to mind. Anyone else? Memory eludes me. Oh, I do like Aphex Twin's ambient stuff. Anything that's kind of, you know, got an electronic edge to it. Echo Sierra says, have you checked out Mortal Kombat X? What do you think of it? I've seen some videos of it. I haven't yet bought it myself, though. I might pick it up at some point. Probably wait till the price comes down a bit. I quite like fighting games. I'm terrible at them. And single player on them tends to be pretty poor. I mean, it just boils down to fight this series of people of ever-increasing difficulty. And I guess that's okay. I kind of wish there was a more compelling single player model for fighting games. I want like a blend between Street Fighter and maybe something like Streets of Rage. That would be interesting. Andy White says, Stu, been a fan of driving games? Are you going to get Project Cars? I'm thinking I might pick it up once they've patched it a little bit. Also, I've got a bit of a backlog going on. So I want to finish some games. I've got The Witcher to finish. What else? Oh, I bought a couple of cheap Xbox One games. I got Shadow Warrior, Need for Speed Rivals, relatively cheap. So I should probably play through those at least once. But there'll probably come a time when Project Cars is at the price point and my desire for a new game is at a critical point, and they'll meet in the middle somewhere and I'll get it. Because I think I would probably quite enjoy it. Although I am, of course, most looking forward to Forza 6 later this year. AFerguson850 says, hey Stu, if you could live your life in any video game, what would it be? I don't know, that's a tough one. Maybe Euro Truck Simulator 2? Get to drive around Europe? And, well, I've already got a pretty well-established company. I could rake in the millions without doing too much, just driving. That'd be alright. Well, what about Rock Band? I could be, a world-famous bassist. I think whatever I chose, it would have to be something with a pretty good soundtrack. I'm going to go with Toe Jam and Earl, because I can't think of anything funkier. Colt Mason says, have you ever considered selling content on Netflix? Iconic Arms on Netflix and History of Graphics may do quite nicely. You know, I wouldn't be averse to this. There are a few legal kinks to work out. I mean, I'm not sure how that would work with regards to my Machinima contract. Exclusivity could be an issue. But if I could work that out, then yeah, I wouldn't be averse to selling content to something like Netflix. It depends on the value that they offer, and also how widespread they are. Because I know Netflix is, you've got to pay to watch Netflix, but it's such a common service, I wouldn't feel too bad by making my content temporarily exclusive to Netflix, for instance. Whereas if it was some new upstart that was challenging Netflix, but wasn't maybe as well known, I would be more reserved. So yeah, I can kind of see avenues like Netflix being an outlet for content providers like myself in the future. But it all depends on the deal, of course. Jacob Bailey says, "Hey Stu, you ever think about doing a face reveal?" I'd never liked the term face reveal. It's like, I don't know, it's an oddly fetishistic sort of term. Lifting the veil, so to speak. I mean, I have issues with the word vlog, but saying, "Are you ever going to do a vlog?" is, I don't know, it's less weird than saying, "Are you ever going to do a face reveal?" Anyway, I don't want to do vlogs, I don't want to be a vlogger, but I was thinking, if I ever did sort of go down the crowdfunding avenue, I was thinking that I might do a monthly vlog or something for contributors only. I don't want any of my serious content to be exclusive for paid subscribers. I want that to be free. I want that to be accessible. But if people want me to sit in front of a camera, then, well, they can pay. So I was thinking it's a possibility, but it will be as part of a Patreon campaign, as part of the incentive. Call it the super bonus, if you like, or the superb onus. Anyway, that's all in the realm of potential and planning. Levi Hicks says, "Ahoy, all your overall thoughts on Titanfall? Something fresh, or just too much of the old?" I like Titanfall. I have a soft spot for Titanfall. I mean, I did cover it with the videos for a little while, but I did genuinely enjoy that game. It was lacking content, but the content that was there was good, and the fundamental mechanics of that game were brilliant. Yeah, I know it's sci-fi, yeah, I know it's space, but I'm not averse to space. It's just I'm a little bit sick of it in Call of Duty. I don't know. I always preferred real guns. So they're doing a Titanfall 2, I think, which should be interesting. Hopefully they'll make it better. Hopefully they'll knock it out of the park. And you never know, it might be quite a big game this generation. Adam L. Wadia says, "Ahoy Stu, have you ever thought about making a special episode exclusively about chemical and or biological warfare? A break from episodes featuring more conventional weapons would be a welcome relief." A special on something like that is a possibility. I'm actually going to talk about some aspect of this during Nuclear Fruit. I think the third episode is about nuclear weapons, and the fourth episode is all about the fallout from using nuclear weapons. So I get to talk about, you know, some aspects of non-conventional warfare like that. I'll tell you the episode names of Nuclear Fruit, actually. There are five parts, and I think the names of each of the parts is now final. They may be subject to change, but part one is called Mechanical Minds. Part two, Lunar Dreams. Part three, Minutes to Midnight. Part four, Toxic Twilight. And part five, Curtain Falls. So that should give you an idea of the structure of this project. As far as length is concerned, I think overall, this is looking like it's going to be at least an hour long. So that's a substantial video for each of the five parts. That's like a good 12 minutes on average. I'm trying to design each of the parts to work as an individual, but they also form a greater story as a complete package. I plan to release them over the course of about a week and a half. I think what I might do is I might start on a Friday. I might do Friday, Sunday, Wednesday, Friday, Sunday. And then maybe the week after, I'll do the super edit, which will be an hour long or more, with all of the episodes edited together. And also, craftily, if there's any mistakes in any of the parts, I'll correct them in the final version. So that's a good solid couple of weeks of output, which is, you know, it's good. It's good, because it's taken me ages to do this project. All right, final question. Luke Hellman says, "Hey Stu, Marmite, do you love it or hate it?" Well, I can confidently say that I don't love it. It's not something I really keep in my kitchen. And I think I've only had it a couple of times. But I don't think I hate it. I wasn't repulsed by it. So I'm starting to think the old adage, you either love it or hate it, I think that might actually be wrong. Marmite, you either love it hate it, or it's kind of, yeah, it's all right, but, you know, I wouldn't have it, maybe. Anyway, thanks for watching. I'm going to go back to work on Nuclear Fruit. And until next week, or maybe a fortnight, depending on how busy I am, farewell.